So this is Reading Columbia, an evening with faculty authors. And we are thrilled to kick off this series with School of the Arts Writing Program Professor Victor LaValle and Professor Monica Miller from Barnard College. And I'll say more about them in just a moment. But first, I'd like to give a shout out to our co-sponsors for this evening, which includes Our Word, Promoting Diversity in Writing, which is a group from the School of the Arts, and the Students of Color Alliance, as well as Columbia Libraries and the School of the Arts. So thank you to all of our co-sponsors for this evening's program. And a little bit about our office, which is the Office of University Life. Our office focuses on university as community and brings students, faculty, and staff together both to work on issues of student life as well as to create engaging opportunities for communities and for community and conversation like tonight's event and reception. So that is our office, the Office of University Life. And now on to this evening's program. Reading Columbia offers all of this that I just mentioned, with featured guests who have thought a lot about inclusion, access, and community from a literary lens. That's the backstory, and so a little bit about what's ahead for us tonight. Joining us tonight is Victor LaValle. He is an assistant professor at Columbia School of the Arts, where he teaches in the writing program, and from which he received his MFA. He is the author of several award-winning books, including Slapboxing with Jesus, his first, published in 1999 to wide critical acclaim, and his most recent, The Ballad of Black Tom, which is tonight's featured work. To share just a few reactions from Ballad of Black Tom, here are some reviews. Quote, a raw meditation on rage, race, and mourning in America. I loved every word. And another, magic, horror, and history created a lens through which injustice today is alarmingly evident. We are also fortunate to have Professor Monica Miller here with us for this conversation this evening. She is an associate professor of English and Africana Studies at Barnard College. Professor Miller also is the published author of two award-winning books and is a specialist in contemporary African-American and Afro-diasporic literature and cultural study. Her latest project examines Black identity formation in Europe. So please help me in welcoming both Victor LaValle and Monica Miller. Thank you both.
Thank you all for coming. This is really exciting for me. This is my second conversation with Victor this week. Victor very graciously came to a class that I'm teaching. So I'm really excited, actually, we're talking about a different book. I'm really excited to have this conversation with Victor about The Ballad of Black Tom and other topics. I wanted to say a little bit about what I admire about Victor's work generally, and then I wanted to say a little bit, my first kind of opening question has to do with some more thoughts about African-American literature in the contemporary period right now. So what I admire most about Victor's work is his generosity. And I see that, I was thinking earlier today, all of his books for me, and in particular, books before this one, which is something I want to get to later on, really include a kind of rollicking, I would say, politics of compassion and empathy. And in particular, I really, really love and connect with the way that Victor values nerds and losers. So for me, that is something that really not only values, but uses them as the basis for heroic narrative in ways that I find really, really moving, right? And that connect, I think, with, as he's found, with the success he's had, really connect with a lot of people. So that's what I wanted Victor to know.
Sure.
So my first question is actually about the kind of state of contemporary African-American literature. I've been teaching this class called Black Literature Now. And in this class, we're reading books that have been published primarily since around, I'm going to say, last 10 years, right? Where there's not a kind of huge kind of critical apparatus, kind of lots of reviews and blog posts,
right? So one of the challenges that we have in this course is challenges and pleasures, right? It's actually kind of connecting and trying to kind of think through what are contemporary Black writers thinking about right now? What are they obsessed with? What are the ways that they're expressing those obsessions, both in terms of form, right, and in terms of content? And generally, we talk about these books as, and this is, I'm using a kind of outdated and also controversial term, as being somewhere in a kind of post-racial reality, right? Either in some ways challenging that very idea, right, or actually kind of exploring it and provoking being provocative, right, in terms of its relationship to that idea, right? So many authors are thinking about the complexities of Blackness, issues related to racialization, thinking about those two things in relationship to creativity and social justice, and what we're calling in my class a kind of Obama adjacent eras. So like immediate pre-Obama, the Obama moment, and then now as we're very sadly moving out of the Obama time. So I wanted to ask Victor in some ways where he thinks his work fits into this general kind of category. One of the things that my students always remark about is that a lot of the writers that we study in this kind of last 10 years are male writers who write about men who write, right? So their characters, their main characters are also authors, right? Who have in some ways, sometimes a bone to pick, right? About publishing and issues around kind of authenticity. So I wanted to ask Victor how you've been thinking about your work in relationship to this other work.
Well, I first thank you all for coming. Monica, thank you for doing this. Sure. I'm really happy to be here tonight. I would say, like, one of the first things I think about is, first thing I should say is, can we all have a round of applause for Paul Beatty, who won the Booker Prize? Yeah. Speaking of writers breaking out of
yes.
things, I would say I was just out of my mind happy for Paul when he got that. And then he also got it for that book yeah. in particular. I mean, I would have been happy for him to get it for any of his books, but for that book in part because I do think it is in some way in that same sort of family, yeah. which says certainly there are aspects of life that are influenced by being Black in America, mm-hmm. things like that, but I think there are new ways to tell these stories, or there are new ways, mm-hmm. new filters through which these stories might be told, you know. And I think if you then expand that and you include how many great new, say, Black African writers
yeah.
who are in the U.S. or raised in the U.S. or living in the U.S. are writing about America now, just that I feel very excited for the ways that when you, like now, I don't think it was ever true, but to say it's a Black book, I think if you say it's a Black book, somebody has, the follow-up question has to be, well, which kind?
Yeah.
Do you know? Mm-hmm. And that is, I think, very nice and very exciting, if only for the sense of surprise
right.
that you might have when you open the book. Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about that sense of surprise. When people open up your books, or we can even talk specifically about The Ballad of Black Tom, what are the ways in which you're trying to kind of get that surprise in there? I mean, one of the easiest ways for us, I think, to think about that would be with kind of genre mix.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, even I would pull in something that you said in as part of the first question,
mm-hmm.
which was about, that I thought was very funny, which was about a lot of the books, the students saying a lot of these books
yeah.
are about Black men who are writers, who are writing.
Before the last
writers,
5 or 6
right?
years.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
yeah.
Uh-huh. And but being interested in that, and also since I teach writing here, right,
mm-hmm.
and thinking about the ways that one of the things many writers find unbelievably interesting is ourselves,
mm-hmm.
right? Is being a writer and writing about writing and all this stuff, right? And that I also find it fascinating
mm-hmm.
and exciting and interesting, and then I also don't.
Right.
Yeah. And that when, so this book now is maybe my, I think it's the sixth book or
mm-hmm.
fifth book. And my first two books were very autobiographical, book of stories and a novel, And but I'd basically written myself all the way up to my MFA program here. And it was also, not coincidentally, when I started doing better with my life. I wasn't falling apart in the same way that I maybe had been falling apart when I was in my early 20s. And I wasn't just a kid being a kid like I was in, when I was a kid. And I had a moment where I knew, I said, like, the next thing I think I might write is going to be about a guy who goes to college and starts to become a writer, and he's trying to be a writer. And then nothing made me less interested than that.
Yeah.
But not because it's an uninteresting subject, but because my experience in it, I felt, was uninteresting, right? And also, I just found it depressing because it was also like I was also living at my mom's place in Queens. So it was, I was sort of like, this is just going to be more stories of, so he lives in this basement, his family's messed up, he's kind of messed up, but he's also going to school. And that had been the last book. So
right.
I didn't need to do that again.
Right.
So what I did was I said, the thing that I needed to think of something, what's the thing I could put into a book that would make me happy? And if I could be happy, since this isn't, at that point, this thing isn't making me rich,
right,
I should at least be happy. And the thing that would make me happy was monsters.
Right.
And I knew, I said, if I can put monsters in my book, I will be a happy person again. Because that's what I grew up on. That is what brought me joy as a child. Mm-hmm. And I think joy has been missing from my books. Certainly from my novel, if not the stories. And so then I started working on my second novel, a book called Big Machine. And I hadn't been that happy in years.
Mm-hmm.
And so ever since then, whether the monsters are real or if they're in someone, if they're psychological and they're sort of a manifestation of someone's ideas instead,
mm-hmm.
That one way or the other, I always felt like, okay, that's a way for me to have fun with this. And then more, and just as importantly, to have my character actually facing something that suggests danger, right? The other fear I had when I was thinking I would be writing about being a writer was the biggest sort of hurdle I'm facing is just me.
Right.
Right?
You were the danger.
And that's, in theory, that's interesting, mm-hmm. but I thought it'd be more interesting to actually have an antagonist or multiple antagonists who could demand something from who could have opposite feelings from my character, who could want things that my character's denying them. And then they could go into battle about it, whether it's actual battle or psychological battle, whatever.
Right.
And I just haven't looked back
mm-hmm.
since. So monsters was the thing.
Okay.
And another way to put that is antagonists was a new thing in
right.
books. for me.
So I want to ask more about monsters and the weird, right? And the uncanny. You said at one point, that the weird is for you the larger task, or is part of the larger task of understanding the utterly impossible true reality of this world. I love that. And you talked about the uncanny, right, as the feeling that we are not alone, right? So I wanted to ask a little bit about kind of monsters, the weird, and the uncanny, and what there's the kind of antagonism, right? But I'm also interested in what the kind of antagonism in some ways with reality, right? And how that fits into the kind of larger project of creating something that isn't necessarily autobiographical, right? But that has elements of, because I think all of your books still have elements of not necessarily your life, right? But of people's kind of everyday lives.
Mm-hmm.
So how do monsters fit into that?
I would also say all the books have my life.
Yes.
I won't even pretend that I'm making up all of
uh-huh.
it. Right? It is absolutely coming from my own life in some ways or another. But I think like the monsters idea, I think it's a pretty universal question that people have, which is about existence, right? Which is just, is this it?
Mm-hmm.
Like, is this everything that there is? I walk around, I go to the store, I buy this, I go home, I put my kids to bed, and in many ways, in a million small ways, it is gratifying and profound. But there's always, at least for me, and I think for most people, there's moments where you're like turning your head too fast and you almost think you saw for a moment the curtain part, right? And you wonder, like, is there something beyond this? And I mean, I feel like that's the religious impulse, but it's also the scientific impulse. Mm-hmm. Both of those impulses are the same, which is just to say, how does this work? And is this all there is, you know? Mm-hmm. And so, for me, I like the use of monsters just because, one definition of monsters is that it's from the Latin for a message from the divine, mm-hmm. right? And that idea that if you think about monsters in work, that oftentimes the good monsters seem as though it's not simply that they are, that person really wanted a parking space, so they shot up my car. Like, that is a monster in the most mundane sense, mm-hmm. right? But even still, even that moment, even that monster could suggest something larger to you, right? But feeling like monsters are great because they cut through a lot of the things as an adult you learn you shouldn't consider, right? You should consider, I mean, as adults, at least for me, I'm trying to make the world ordered for myself and mm-hmm. for my children and for my wife. I'm trying to, for my students, I'm trying to show up having read their work and have something worthwhile to say, hopefully. Uh-huh. I'm trying to, for my employer, I'm trying to like show up every, you know, mm-hmm. show up to every class and, for the IRS, I'm trying to pay the taxes, right? Yeah. All this various stuff. There's all these ways that I am agreeing with everybody else above a certain age right. to act as if the world has order.
Yes.
And then every once in a while, in almost everyone's life, things pop in to say, you're just wrong. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that thing is cancer. Sometimes that thing is I saw there was a thing in the paper this weekend about a guy whose son, I think it was just sitting on a bench in front of the park, and a piece of a building fell on his son's head, just killed him, and it wasn't because the building was poorly made. It wasn't because there was no reason that one could point to and say this is the reason, this is the blame. It was just literally a monster. It was just the disorder of the world. Mm-hmm. And just thinking, like, in your life, how do you address that? How do you deal with that kind of thing? And on one level, I don't know that you can, right? You're just left with questions. But in that space, you might put a faith, a scientific theory, mm-hmm. or a dragon with three heads that tests the mettle of a hero, right? But they are all the same thing in the end.
No, I really like your the kind of really broad definition of monster, right? So it's not, you know, you're not talking about the creature from the swamp, although I see lots of creatures in the swamps in your books. And you're talking about kind of random evil, mm-hmm. Accident, right? So I mean, the idea that the monstrous can take so many different forms, and the ways in which you move. I think the monsters in your books are of those multiple forms.
Yeah.
Is really amazing because it allows you to have a whole set of other kinds of conversations.
Yeah.
Right. About, as you said, religion. About faith and belief, which is shot through. I think all of your books. Right. I mean, if the monstrous is filling in something, it's related to that. In terms of how do we? It's an epistemological question as well as questions of faith. So I wanted to ask something more specific about the Ballad of Black Tom. Mm. So in terms of thinking about the conversation that novella
is really a short, long story. But.
Okay, we'll call it a novella.
We gotta make it a
book. That book is really concerned, right, with a specific conversation, mm-hmm. right, and a specific conversation that is really very much involved with the monstrous, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't know when I read the book, and I don't know how many of you did either, that Victor is in a conversation with H.P. Lovecraft. Maybe you all know this. Okay, this is something that I had to figure it out. And I went to to read the short story that Lovecraft wrote. That the book is in dialogue with. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if you could say a little bit about the Lovecraftian monstrous, right? And how it is that you came to want to respond, I don't want to put it so simply, but to use that world as part of the world that you're trying to create in your book.
Sure. So maybe as a capsule summary, just in case there's anybody who also doesn't know about Lovecraft. H.P. Lovecraft was a writer from Providence, Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. He wrote during the 1920s. He wrote stories that are considered foundational texts of a certain kind of horror story called the weird. In his works, for the most part, there's usually a man, somewhat anxious man, who discovers there are hideous and awful secrets about the universe, and that those secrets at heart are that the universe does not care about us, that there are beings in this universe that are much larger than us, that rather than being evil, have absolutely no interest in us, but just by their existence, if they were to, say, wake from their deep slumber deep in the seas of the South Pacific or something like that, would wipe out all of humanity with a shrug of their shoulder. And so one of the things he's sort of wrestling with at the time when he's writing is there's a new way of understanding the world, and part of that understanding is part of the scientific revolution, right? And the idea that old ideas about human beings being the center of all existence, that we are God's chosen this, that even that we, all our gods from all over the world care about us in whatever ways, he felt as though science was showing that this was, in his mind, absolutely untrue, and that in fact we were just some small speck on one small rock mm-hmm. in an incredibly vast universe. And in the face of that, how could you not think that we are all we are beings of vanity and pride, to think that we matter at all in this existence, right? And that's kind of the basis mm-hmm. of his horror, is just that terror at the idea that I do not matter and you do not matter, and all these things we're working so hard for, doesn't matter. It's a blink of an eye, and it's even like the being that's blinking doesn't care, right? And so that was pretty chilling, all right, yeah. and powerful.
It's like the cosmic sublime.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's exactly yeah. right. And so I first read his. So he wrote these stories in the 20s, and if more than 100 people cared, I would be surprised, right?
Yeah.
He died assuming he had failed at his mm-hmm. at his task. He barely published any of his stories in very small publications, read by a very, very small community of readers. But those readers became really, really loyal to the things he created and to the ideas behind it, that idea of cosmic insignificance, mm-hmm. right? And then generations and generations of people wrote stories in his sort of echoing his work, or even using some of his own characters and ideas, and they also published his work and read his work and shared his work, to the point now where there's a Library of America of H.P. Lovecraft, right? Like he has become a foundational person in pop culture and all this kind of stuff, right? So I grew up with reading his stuff when I was maybe 10 or 11 or 12. And when you're that age, or if you're a certain kind of kid at that age, the idea that the world does not care about you and you are deeply insignificant seems about right for what it feels like when you're 10, when you're like a lonely 10-year-old, right? And so it actually spoke to me amazingly well. And then add to that, his creatures, his monsters, his beings, they're as big as this room and they have 1,000 tentacles and they kill. Yeah. It's amazing, right? It's like exactly what you want when you're a certain kind of 10-year-old. And so I really loved that stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was just frightening and fun and all this, you know. And then I think when I was about 13 or 14, and I was still reading him and I was reading other people too, but I was coming back to him, mm-hmm. and I started to realize, I think this guy has some really objectionable views about anybody who's not a white male from New England.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? It's not even just like, I mean, he's afraid. I wouldn't even say he hates. He is afraid yeah. of everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody in the world, he fears, right, in some way or another. And so I had issues with him because of that fear, because of the ways that that prejudice sort of bubbled up and all this mm-hmm. in the work. And then I came back to that work again, maybe like in my 30s,
right.
and was able at that point to both not gloss over the ways that he was a being of like extreme prejudice, mm-hmm. but I also still felt the great love and affection that I had for him, when I read this stuff when I was 10 or 12,
yeah.
right? And now I also had this appreciation for the ways that there are a lot of writers from pretty much every tribe of any kind whose work is riddled with their own prejudices, mm-hmm. right? And most of them I think most of those things sink those books when you read them 50 years later, 100 years later. Those books just can't last because all they are is an attempt to justify those feelings. Yeah. Whereas one of the things that Lovecraft, I think, did really well was he channeled all that anxiety and fear into stories and ideas and characters that were just ambiguous enough that even a black kid from Queens in 1980, whatever, mm-hmm. could read those stories and see my own experience right. in them and see my fears in them and all that stuff. And I really feel like that's the reason he lasts and he has become something more deeply embedded
right.
than a lot of other writers who were much, much more popular at the time
mm-hmm.
And who are much more popular even now, right?
Yeah.
That he will last in ways that they won't.
Mm-hmm.
But all those conflicted feelings were coming together last summer. I had just finished up a book,
mm-hmm.
but I still had the, you know, you finish up something and it's sort of like you've been working out a lot, so you're in really good shape. And you say, well, I did that all to run this 5K, 10K, whatever you think sounds like a lot of running,
mm-hmm.
right? Maybe I could run a little short, half of 2.5K, just real quick.
Yeah.
I could just do it because I still got the juice or whatever. And so I just sat down and I said, I'm just going to write this thing really fast.
Wow.
And so I wrote it over part of that summer.
Mm-hmm.
And then I told my wife, I said, this is the stupidest thing I ever wrote. Nobody's going to want to read this thing. It's H.P. Lovecraft plus kind of Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to read that. And I was like, I'm just going to like, I remember originally I was gonna tweet the whole thing. Like I was gonna just make it a series of tweets and all this because no one will want it and blah, blah, blah. And then I sent it to this editor at Tor
mm-hmm. yeah.
And she just said, I want this. And I think this is
yeah.
a book.
Okay.
This should be a book.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, okay, let's make it a book. And that was a much better choice than tweeting out the whole book.
Yes, it was. It was. Although so, we would have enjoyed that, but in a very different way.
I mean, I can't even read those things for that long.
Yeah,
so,
no.
Jennifer Egan did it for a short story, and I think that was about as long as I probably
managed.
Could do it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think Twitter has just become, I mean, if we were having to do that now with all the other things that are currently on Twitter, given, I think there would have been a lot of failure.
Right.
So that's actually, I mean, the story then that you're responding to is actually, what's it called? It's called The Murder.
The Horror at Red Hook,
right? And you start your story from Harlem.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I've been thinking a lot about the Harlem piece,
yeah.
right? Or the way in which the story begins and ends in Harlem.
Mm-hmm.
And Tommy Tester, right? We see him with his father at the beginning of the book, and then at the end of the book, he's with his friend Buckeye.
Yeah.
Buckeye. I was wondering how you were thinking. Why move? Because the story now centers on Tommy, who's living in 1924 Harlem during the Harlem Renaissance, right? But we're seeing it from a slightly different angle, right? I wanted to say a little bit about that addition, what you were trying to, how you were trying to kind of move, kind of Lovecraftian, the good Lovecraft, right?
Yeah.
Or work with, in some ways, what Lovecraft is doing and respond to him by making that particular change.
Well, one of the things, so the story that I was I was responding to and also riffing off of.
Yeah.
Takes place in Red Hook, Brooklyn. It takes place there, and the basic idea is like this cop stumbles onto a horrible set of cultish crimes being committed by all the various, as far as the novel, I mean, as the story in Lovecraft are concerned, horrible immigrants
right.
who are destroying Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically the tenor of the story. The first reason I wanted to move it to Harlem, I mean, one, I thought it was 1924, to not have Harlem in the
yeah.
story seemed like a waste because it's such a great period for Harlem
yes.
That I just wanted to have it
mm-hmm.
there, right? But the other reason, if I'm being totally honest, was I don't know Red Hook that well. But we live up in Washington Heights,
yeah.
so we come down to Harlem fairly regularly,
mm-hmm.
and I felt like, I think I got Harlem though.
Uh-huh.
In my childhood, I spent more than enough time coming into right. Harlem. So I wanted that in there, and also, you know, to give credit to Harlem, I also wanted Tommy to have what I always thought of, I'm from Queens, but Harlem swagger, right? Like, it's a particular thing to be a black man from Harlem, mm-hmm. as opposed to anywhere else even in New York City. Maybe Brooklyn also has its thing. But mm-hmm. Brooklyn and Harlem, that's it. And so I said, he's got to be from one of those two, right?
Right.
And so once I knew that, I felt like, okay, I know this place and I can write about this place. But it was also, I thought, to expand his map, because Lovecraft wrote about this story set in Brooklyn because he married in his 30s, I believe, mm-hmm. a woman named Sonia Green. She moved him down from Providence because he wouldn't work his entire life. He couldn't hold on to a job. His wife said basically, like, if I'm going to be the one taking care of you, you need to come move where I'm going to work. And he kind of reluctantly said, fine, I guess, if you have to, then I'll do that, right? And she was a remarkable woman in her own right. She was basically like, she came to Brooklyn because she was starting her own hat business. And she was also like an independent journalist, mm-hmm. basically doing what we would call now like almost like Twitter journalism or something like that on her own. Like she was this very interesting woman. Mm-hmm. And so he moves with her to Red Hook. And immediately regrets it, right? And within, I think, a year, he's moved back to Rhode Island, and she's moved on with her life, mm-hmm. right? She remarries and all this. But all that energy is there in his Red Hook, but I felt like, but he doesn't write about Red Hook all that deeply. It's just more like there's these immigrants here, and you can't trust them. They're all swarthy and mysterious and all this kind of stuff. And I wanted to, in Harlem, I said, like, well, I guess a lot of us are also swarthy, but swarthy and more complex.
Yes, in more complex ways. Yeah. And the way that you characterize Harlem is for Tommy, right, is as a community, right, as a place of kind of solace and comfort. I mean, the moments when you narrate Tommy kind of going out into the boroughs are really beautiful moments because he's leaving something that seems really very very. You know, it's clear that his swagger is coming from this sense of belonging, right? And then moving out into Queens, and then when he goes into Brooklyn, these are places where he brings that swagger with him on the streets, right? But really feels very alienated from, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, in terms of the way that you talk about Harlem, or the way that Tommy feels about Harlem, and the fact that he's there at the beginning and then again at the end, was really beautiful to me, because it was showing a kind of, as I said, kind of other side mm-hmm. of how we think about the Harlem Renaissance, right?
Yeah.
As a place where, you know, people are sitting up and, you know, drinking champagne and writing, you know, literary fiction, right? But there are also people like Tommy who just took kind of a great deal of kind of pride and strength pride and strength from being from that place and like kind of going out into New York from that space.
Right.
It was really incredibly well... incredibly moving to see that part of it. He also has a lot of experiences of what you know, what we call kind of everyday racism, right? And other kinds of more kind of systemic. We see evidence of other kinds of systemic issues. Can you say a little bit about that in terms of, you know, you said it's a little bit of Black Lives Matter, mm-hmm. And what was the other part?
And H.P. Lovecraft.
Lovecraft and Black. Can you say a little bit about that part of how Tommy becomes the main character of this kind of mystery mm-hmm. novel that's also like an unbelievable tale of revenge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I definitely am, I often feel like the thing that I feel is often missing from fiction for me is the experience of what it's like to move inside a certain body.
Mm-hmm.
Right, like I'm told in a story, this is what a character is, this is who they are, this is where they're from. But then I think, to give each author credit, and myself credit, when I'm writing early drafts, mm-hmm. then you are so used to, if it's a person who's somewhat like you in some way,
mm-hmm.
you are so used to being you and moving in the world as you, that you forget to include all these details of what moving through the world like you is like. But for me, I think those details are what, it's sort of the idea, like that's what makes up who you are, is in part how the world tells you who you are, you know? And so the example I like to give is something that happened about 5 years ago. that made me think about this idea of like also even of like being a man in a man's body kind of thing. So 5 years ago now, a little bit more, maybe 5 and a half, my wife and I were living in Amsterdam. Yeah. And we were there for, I had a fellowship, we were living there. And while she was there, she got pregnant with our first child. And a few months in, 4 months, whatever month it was in, she started showing, right? And at some point she was showing a fair bit. And then one day she came back home and she was really like kind of, I could see she was a little off, right? Mm-hmm. And I said, what's going on? What's the matter? She said, I was walking down the street and this guy said something. I like to tell the story, but I've also told my wife, I've agreed, she's told me, just don't say what he said, because I just don't want that repeated. Mm-hmm. Like just in the world, right? Mm-hmm. But he said something very, very vulgar that was tied to her pregnancy, mm-hmm. but also sexual and all this. And I became like incensed. I was just like, let's go find that dude, whatever, like this. And she just sort of like laughed and she said, you're not strong enough to be a woman. That's, you know what, that one time you're gonna fight? Yeah. Do you know how many times you would be fighting every day if you were walking as me in this world, as any woman mm-hmm. in this world? And it was this really nice moment because I was just really like, oh, fuck. Mm-hmm. I just had never thought about it because why would I think about it, right? Because it's not something that was done to me, mm-hmm. right? And as a result, I got to think that the world doesn't work that way. Like that was the privilege of it, is I get to think that's not true, mm-hmm. right? And thinking about it that way, in my writing, but especially in Black Tom, I realized like when I was first writing Black Tom, there are a lot of incidents where you get to see Tommy, when he leaves Harlem especially, have to navigate the world as a black man, as he essentially leaves a place where, when he's in Harlem, he's a black man among many black men, and so there he is on some level, he's Tommy. He's the way he dresses. He's Charles the fact Thomas that he's a bad Chester. Yes. Mm-hmm. He's the fact that he's a bad musician. He has personal qualities that people know and recognize. Mm-hmm. And that is how the world tells him who he is and how he tells the world who he is. But as he leaves Harlem and he goes to other parts of New York that are less and less all black, he is no longer one of many. Mm-hmm. He becomes singular, and suddenly the world starts to tell him something different about himself. Mm-hmm. And it starts to teach him the way it expects him to act in the world, or what it expects him to take, how it expects him to be treated. It expects him not to walk with as much pride. It expects him to walk with a certain degree of subservience. It expects him to keep his eyes down. It expects him not to talk back. Mm-hmm. It expects all these things. And it expects all those things so that he can have the privilege of getting to his job and then coming home again to his father, mm-hmm. right? And that story I tell about my mom, I mean, sorry, there's a slip, about my wife, sorry.
I won't ask any more.
Sorry. I'll just wipe that from my memory now. But about my wife, that conversation was really instructive to me when I was thinking about this book and about that aspect in particular, because it was a little bit of a nudge for me to say, like, what are the things you are taking for granted about moving through the world that would actually help to make your story better and that would help to make things more complicated? Because, like, a version where I didn't pay attention to that would just be Tommy leaves Harlem and then he just goes to this place out in Queens and he drops off this secret book with weird writing in it, and then he comes home and you kind of say like, well, okay, I guess I'm sort of interested in the book, maybe. But if instead you see he's this black man moving from this place where he feels comfortable and safe, and he's moving to a place of non-safety where he's taught that you are not safe and all this stuff, but you also know, but he's got this weird magical book, and you start thinking this is a complicated situation, and then maybe as a reader you say, I'm interested in this, you know, that I was trying to get all that stuff into the book, and so it so all those things matter. Harlem mattered, the fact that he was black mattered, the fact that the politics of it mattered, but it really stemmed from the idea that the body actually matters, right? Like, and especially in writing, if you're really inside, like one of the pleasures of reading about another character is to learn how they think differently in the world, right? but is also to understand how they actually live differently in the world, how the world does not let them live the same way as you, mm-hmm. right? But, you know, I think for the most part, writers and people who read seriously are mostly very heady people, and we mostly live inside our brains, mm-hmm. and so we forget that we have bodies, and as a result, they don't show up on the page very much. And for me, at least, I think that's a big loss. Because then there's just all this data that you're just not letting the reader have.
Yeah. I mean, even though you say that you were paying really close attention to that in this book, I feel like the concentration that you have in other books on touch is part of that, right? So you're saying in some ways here that one of the things you're really interested in with Tommy and with the world around Tommy and your relationship to Lovecraft and that is about a kind of embodied experience and embodied kind of racialized and gendered experience, mm-hmm. right? Kind of making narrative around that. But I found in a lot of your other books, though, the touch is a really important thing, and that has to do with in some ways kind of empathy, mm-hmm. right, and compassion. So I think, I mean, you're interested in, I think you're, You've always been interested in this kind of embodied question, right? But you've exposing it or bringing it to the narrative in different ways, depending on whether you're talking about a kind of embodiment or a kind of body to body.
I think that's right.
Relationship, right? Because I find that's also one of the things that really moves me about your work is because often the touches that you're talking about are ultimately given by men, mm-hmm. right? And I was thinking about gender in this book, in particular, right? Because it is so masculine, right? It is really masculine, but yet has these kinds of moments, right? That are we can think of as haptic, if we're using a kind of technical term, right? Between Tommy and his father, right? That are really kind of tender and beautiful, compassionate and empathetic. That you see take place in the Harlem space, right? But once Tommy leaves that space, the swagger that he has is really, kind of signaling his own sense of self, or it's a part of his own sense of self-protection, mm-hmm. right? So another question I had was about Tommy and music, mm-hmm. right? You said you might be interested in the book. I'm interested not only in the book, right? The alphabet, the library, right? Kind of those kind of geeky literary things, right? Yeah. I'm also interested in Tommy's music. One of the things that I think is that also struck me about Tommy's character is that that he's a bad musician.
Yeah.
But really, nevertheless, enjoys the music, right? Yeah. So he's willing to be bad. Right. at this kind of creative act because it seems to really be really kind of fulfilling to him.
Yeah.
So I wanted and he also with the book, right, with the zigzag zig book, he also seems to kind of understand like he's involved in these not necessarily kind of creative endeavors, but there's something also about what Mayotte is doing mm-hmm. with that book and how he reacts to how do you pronounce the name of the Sudam.
Yeah.
How he's working with the occult, like kind of in these kind of creative practices of kind of tapping into other knowledge.
Right.
Can you say something about that?
I will say, despite what I said earlier about not wanting to write about writers being writers, uh-huh. I did feel like this book was actually about being a writer.
Yeah.
Very, mm-hmm. very much. Mm-hmm. Right. But I wanted to channel it through being a hustler. Since to me that's really what a writer is, right? You're trying to trick people into giving you money for something that didn't cost you anything.
Yeah.
And that if you whenever you pull that off, if you get paid a buck or a lot more than a buck, it feels really good because mm-hmm. you kind of pulled one over on people. Mm-hmm. At least that's how I think of it, mm-hmm. right? Like I can't believe they paid for it, right? I would have done it for free, but it's better to get paid, mm-hmm. Right? Or to be read, or whatever. I'm supposed to say that sounds less predatory or something, right? But I did think of him I wanted him to be, he was a creative person who was bad at each way he tried to be creative. Mm-hmm. And so I thought of him like, so I don't want to say she's bad, but my mother was a legal secretary. She was all her life till she retired. Mm-hmm. But every weekend, every Saturday, my mom was painting, drawing, playing the piano, mm-hmm. Sculpting, whatever it was that was her interest. Right. And even though it was not a household where anyone would have said, I'm an artist, I know my mother was an artist. Mm-hmm. And I know she made it seem like a thing that, I mean, she never tried to sell these things or anything like that. She did it for pleasure and joy.
Right.
She did it because it made herself happy and because she liked sharing it with us, mm-hmm. right? But she was also very hard on herself. She would say, I'm not very good at any of this kind of thing. So I wanted to sort of take that idea and then almost in a way turn it and say, but you are, you know, that in itself, that impulse to do it for the pleasure, for the joy of it, is its own victory, you know? And is the one victory, like, whether or not you make money, whether or not you get this or that, they can't take that. I mean, as cheesy as it is, they can't take that from you if you don't let them,
mm-hmm.
right? And that the maybe to some degree the heartbreak that Tommy has at the end is, I do feel like the heartbreak that a writer, as writers or any kind of artist, you can fall into, which is, when is the point where I stopped doing this because that was a pleasure for me and I started doing it for adulation? I started doing it to try to make money. I started doing it to try to get a job. And that all those things start to leach out the thing that was maybe probably the joyous spark.
Part of it.
Yeah.
Mm. Huh. So if you think about, when does that happen for you in the book, though? When Tommy, because I can think of a couple of different moments when, if I'm trying to think about his creativity and when that when he shows up like the third time, mm-hmm. at Sudam's house, or when does that happen? For you?
Like, when does he become an artist?
Or when does he kind of quote unquote sell his soul?
Well, I would say that they happen at the same time, right? When he becomes the villain, he sells his soul and he also becomes the best
artist he could be.
But he's an artist of evil and chaos and violence, right? But he's really good at it. And I really like respect him for that.
Am I getting a signal?
I don't know. Should we do one last question?
Okay. One last question.
Yeah.
This is completely related to what you were talking about before. Tommy's heroic status, right? I mean, one of the things I really enjoy about your work in general is the idea of the kind of like haphazard hero, right? The person who... So I want to talk about, are we supposed to think about Tommy as a hero, right? Because in some ways, you know, given the kind of political climate and, you know, kind of assault against black life and, you know, the way that we kind of have been in mourning, how do we think about Tommy as a hero? Could we? Should we?
Yeah.
How do we kind of process what happens with him, right? Because, I mean, in some ways, you know, we're with him, but it's horrific, right? Or we're kind of with him. I mean, we are though, and that's I mean, in some ways, what you've done incredibly well, because we're absolutely with him, and we're sort of like, wow, this is interesting. Like, he's harnessing the cosmic power, right? Which is not something we normally have access to. So I wanted to hear you say a little bit about that piece of it, and.
Right.
And in some ways, like, what, not necessarily what we should think, but what you were thinking.
Well, I mean, I certainly thought of, so toward the end of the book, Tommy is in his full powers, and he just starts just killing cops, just left and right, all over New York City. And then also killing lots of other white people, too, just all over, right, with impunity. And the way I really thought of it was, I thought of my, so my, so I, this will get back to it. my uncle grew up, he loved John Wayne movies, right? He was of an age where John Wayne movies were a thing that he loved. And so he would sit down with me and try to get me to love these movies. But I was a kid, and I think maybe in some way, like, it was just, they were just not right for me, right? But what he would talk about sometimes was his conflicted feeling, where, like, the point of the movie is trying to get you to enjoy John Wayne, the cowboy, out in the Wild West, clearing the land for the good settlers, right? But my father was my uncle was he was Ugandan. He had lived through British rule. Mm-hmm. He had a complex political apparatus, and so he could not just simply say, "Yeah, John Wayne, kill those Indians. That's great." Mm-hmm. He couldn't, right? But the way it was done was just so fun, mm-hmm. right? And the way it was done was so, like, the movie built these things to be exciting and gratifying. Mm-hmm. They were so terrible. Look what they did. They came in and burned down the pioneer's house, and they took the daughter away, and look what kind of monsters they are. Mm-hmm. Right? And so I really was thinking about that idea of, like, how much would it take, like, that John Wayne story. It's been done since, right? Unforgiven, stuff like that.
Yeah.
How much would it take for that person to be essentially the devil? And it wouldn't take very much for John Wayne to be the devil, yeah? If you just told a slightly different version of that story from another perspective. And so I thought, like, well, what if I let Tommy have every justifiable reason for mm-hmm. what he's doing, mm-hmm. and you still will feel like, I shouldn't enjoy this. I shouldn't enjoy this. Mm-hmm. But I was having a blast, mm-hmm. just murdering people, mm-hmm. right? And in particular, murdering the agents of the state.
Yeah.
I mean, it was great. I mean, part of the point of imagination is you just get to do that stuff you cannot do, and you know generally you do not want to do to the level that you do in a book, right?
Right.
And so I really thought of, like, I thought he is a hero who damns me by my pleasure in him, mm-hmm. right? And so in that way, I get to be my uncle and I get to be John Wayne,
right?
At the same time. And that I feel like is the best. Like, it if you're coming out of a thing where someone, a character is killing lots of people with impunity, and you never have doubts about that, that strikes me as a very bad way to think, right? Mm-hmm. About life, right? On some level, you should be thinking, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But shoot someone else. Mm-hmm. Or whatever, right? Because they deserve it, right?
Right.
So.
Okay. I think we have time. We're going to do questions. Yeah? Questions from the audience?
You have to go up to the mic and sing your question. No, just kidding.
Thank you very much. It's very interesting to hear your perspective on, the Harlem, your experience in Europe with your wife. That was, it made me think about Donald Trump, and I don't mean to be political here, but you wanted to react when your wife had somebody telling her, some things.
Yeah.
I was just curious if we can talk a little bit about. We live in a time and age that's amazing what's happening. And in 2 weeks, the presidential election that never happened before. In 240 years, the candidate can openly talk about things like that.
Yeah.
I was just curious about your opinion. And as a writer, if you are to write a book about this in the future, how would that character be?
The character of Donald Trump?
Or a character that suffered his, the way he treats people, as your wife was treated in Europe,
right.
I was just trying to relate to today's.
Yeah.
It's happening right now, and the way he treated some women before. So
I see. Well, but I would say if I was going to write about it, to me if you're doing fiction, the interesting thing would be. To not be on the, and it's my own politics, I suppose, and my love for my wife, I guess. I think not that, it's just intellectually. I feel like the sides on this seem too, at least to my mind, too clearly there's a right and a wrong in this moment. So I wouldn't necessarily write about, I would feel like that's not the thing, or I'm not the person to write that thing. Right, I'm the person who will pay to read the book by the person who should write about that thing. because I'm not equipped. And I just mean, like, literally, when I watch it, I just think it's an old idea, but the idea that nobody could make this up kind of stuff is just absolutely true. And there are some things that you just sort of say, respect, I'm just going to let reality deal with this, right? And in 20 years from now, we'll dig into this stuff. Some reporter will find out, like, what were all the back channel things that were also going on that are undoubtedly even more horrific and sad than whatever we're finding out, you know? But if I'm honest, I just think at this moment, I certainly do not have enough distance or perspective to write rationally about this moment, so it would take a while. And I would be suspicious of anybody who tried to write about it immediately. Yeah.
Good afternoon. So I found it really interesting that you were talking about setting this in the 1920s in Harlem with such a sense of belonging and community. And I wanted you to talk to the fact, or compare that more so to how do you feel that has progressed or retrogressed in today's age, that sense of belonging and community within the Black community?
In Harlem in particular, or?
In general.
Well, I mean, you know, one of the things that I try to dig out in the, or show in the book is, so Tommy and his father, I guess obviously, are Black Americans, right? And so they have a very deep, they have a sense of ownership of Harlem, a feeling of ownership of Harlem. And there's a running idea early on in the book that is about this place called the Victory Club, which is where new Caribbean immigrants, Black Caribbean immigrants and Latino and Latina Caribbean immigrants, but in this case it's particularly Black Caribbean immigrants, that's where they go, and Tommy and his father, and by the inference is the Black American community, have all these stories about what it's like in the Victory Club. And you know how those Caribbean Blacks are, they're like, they're rough and they're wild, and the kind of stuff that goes on there inside there will turn your hair white and blah blah blah. And then about halfway through the book they get to the Victory Club and it's just a tea room. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And people just sell sandwiches, and women from different Caribbean islands who have immigrated here, they make meals. The way they make their money is they make meals each day, women from Puerto Rico, then someone from Jamaica, then someone from Costa Rica. They just go through the Victory Club selling their food to other Black Caribbean people and Latino Black Caribbean, Afro Caribbean people who are just eating lunch or having breakfast or eating dinner on their, and the Black Americans have this moment of being like, oh, I thought these Caribbean Blacks were wild. I guess we should just sit down, and do I need a coat? Or, you know, like that kind of thing. And so what I wanted to talk in the book about, definitely about tensions between the Black American Tommy Tester and Black Americans in general and white America, but I also wanted to talk about within intra-community tensions and the ways that even within a supposedly homogeneous community, that is just not true, that can't be true, and that even within supposed, the way that America reduces people to two or maybe three or four groups in no way recognizes the levels of complexity and antagonism and misunderstanding and all that stuff within those groups. And so I wanted to also suggest that, like, he thinks he owns Harlem. He thinks this is mine. This is the place that has made me. It's all, and then he starts to discover, oh, even this place is actually more complicated than I thought. And I was living with a certain degree of ignorance or stereotype that isn't that different than what I experienced when I went out to Queens amongst all those white people, right? And that in that way, my hope is by the end, he and the reader both start to think, I think this, unfortunately, all of this is much more complex than I thought it was. And I don't have as simple a grasp of the world as I can't get by with a simple grasp of the world, right? So that certainly is, like, embedded in the text, and I hope that idea of, like, you know, it's just nobody, I mean, myself included, nobody ever wants the world to be complicated, right? Because when it's complicated, you can't make easy allegiances, you can't make easy decisions, and then more importantly, sometimes you are guilty of a thing that you are angry at somebody else for being guilty of, or you have a power, that you sort of say, I want these things to change. I want the system to change. I agree that this system is oppressive and all this, but just let me keep this. You know what I mean? And that almost everybody, there's a certain point where you would say, if you really pull back their curtain, you say, there is this one little thing I would like to keep. Can I please have that? And you say, and that, you know, and that on in real life, that there's the point of this is to argue over this and try to make the world better. But in fiction, I think the point to some degree is to just say, look, it's just complex, right? Mm-hmm. And hopefully it's also entertaining. Yeah. Or at least you get to the end, yeah. Right?
I mean, you did that also with the white characters, which I thought was interesting, because when I first was reading the Sudan character, I was like, oh, he's assembling like this multiracial crowd of immigrants who are going to do something, right? And then it's when you realize that, yes, he's got them doing things,
yeah.
Right? But he's unwilling to give up, right?
That's
his
right.
own power.
He's right. going to lead them in.
He's
going to
lead
doing.
Them, right?
Because they still need a leader.
Exactly.
Yes.
Or the fact that the detective Malone, he sees things.
Yeah.
Right. That the other cops don't see, right? The fact that he has this ability, right? But both of them, in some ways, are not able, right, to use those particular talents,
right?
In ways that benefit more people than themselves.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, they're still they're just limited human beings.
Exactly. Questions? Comments?
Hello. Hi. I have a quick question about your prose.
Yeah.
I noticed the prose has changed from your very earlier book.
Yeah.
So you wrote this one after The Devil in Silver?
Yes.
And even I read The Devil in Silver, and I think they are kind of different.
Yeah.
This one, yeah, so... Do you want to talk about prose?
Well, I think certainly like this one is probably the most spare thing I've ever written. Sounds the least, it's definitely like not slangy or anything like that, not conversational. But in this case, part of the reason for that was, so H.P. Lovecraft, again, if you haven't read him, he was one of the things he's famous for is he has this really, really dense and sort of archaic prose. And part of the reason he did that is he felt in some ways like he felt like he was a man born in the wrong time. He wished he'd been born 50 years earlier, 100 years earlier. Mm-hmm. When he felt like a man like him would have been appreciated and would have been, even like his family was actually of greater wealth and all this and privilege, but by the time he was born, the family was on hard times. And so he sort of felt like, well, 100 years ago, I would have been like a prince, you know, but now I'm just an overeducated pauper. Kind of thing, right? And so his writing, especially if you're new to it as an adult, you read it and you just say, I can't even understand this. It's so dense, and it uses
five adjectives.
Yes, I mean yeah. The level of it. I mean, I can't even off the top of my head can't even think of anything that would capture how clotted. It's sort of like clotted milk, you know, when you pour it out, and that. Is not appealing to everybody, right? But in this case, I was trying to, the mistake that a lot of people make when they write in the shadow of H.P. Lovecraft is they try to mimic that writing style. And you can't really mimic it because he was almost like the last one to do, he's basically like the last in a certain line that he's tracing back 100 years, 150 years. So the idea of like just doing it again, you know, is sort of like that, sixth or seventh or tenth generation royal who's kind of inbred and, you know, you wouldn't want them to rule any longer. You wouldn't want that family line to rule any longer. That's what it reads like when people are still imitating that, I think. So I just thought I'm just going to strip everything away and I'm just going to do this one, in particular this one, super straight as far as the writing is. Almost no flourishes in the language to battle that thing that people are expecting. It's not my, I wouldn't say like the next book I'm working on is not quite this spare. But it was actually a lot of fun, I have to be honest, to be this, to not try to show off, I can write a sentence like this, look at the way I can describe this tree, look at this. To not have the chance, the right to do any of that stuff was actually really freeing and exciting. So, but thanks for that.
One more question?
Hi,
thank you so much. Your conversation made me really excited to read the book. I haven't read it yet. So I have a question. I guess I'm wondering, was there, it sounds like an immensely complicated and many complex ideology, and was there anything that you couldn't include in this book, ideas or philosophy that you wanted to, but it just didn't fit? And then another question is, in your writing process, did you have to do any research, or is it very much intuitive?
So as far as like what I couldn't include, I mean, on one level, there are a lot of things that, there are some things that are actually in the original story, The Horror of Red Hook, that I just jettisoned and decided not to bother to keep because they don't make any sense. Right, like when you read the story, especially toward the end, you literally read and go like, I just don't even understand what is happening here. And you can tell he just wrote it fast and then he just sold it, right? It's a lot like Poe in that way, like the bad Poe stuff. I was just telling my friend about this. He has a novel called The Narrative of Arthur Gordon Pym. It's his only novel. But when you read it, this is Poe now, you can tell he just thought of something and just added it and then didn't even go back to change. So like there's a character, he's on a ship. He's out at sea. They're going to the Arctic, and he goes down below. And Poe, you can tell, realizes. Oh, and Poe ends a chapter with like there was the sound of something strange in the hold with him, and then the next chapter it turns out like the thing that was strange is his dog, like his personal dog. And you say, wait a second, four chapters in, and he hadn't thought that his dog was on the boat. This doesn't even, what? Right? And you realize it's just that Poe was just like, oh, he needs his dog. Yes, okay. And then like he's on a life raft and there's the dog and there's one crewman and the main character. But he realizes plot-wise he needs another person. So he just goes, there was another man hiding in the back of the lifeboat in chapter 9. He just goes, okay, Poe, yeah. Sure. Right? And so in that way, I think one of the things that is sort of overlooked about the older writers, and especially the ones who were writing really fast just to make barely anything to live, is they were not revising these things 10 times. They write these things once, sell this for 50 cents so I can buy a beer. That's what they were thinking, right? So a good there's a portion of Lovecraft's story that just is genuine, like nonsense. And I said, I don't need to be beholden to nonsense. So I threw that out, right? And I inserted stuff from other stories of his that are better stories. And I just decided, I it's my right, I'm just going to take whatever works. And the only test will be if, when I give this to the editor to read, if she says this doesn't make sense or this isn't working, then I'll consider that I shouldn't use it. But she, and this editor knew Lovecraft backward and forward. But if she felt like, I get it, I can see how this gets to be there, blah, 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 then I won. Then that was it, right? And then, I'm sorry, the second part of the question was about...
About research.
Oh, yes. Well, in this case, what was easy was that I had Lovecraft's story, so there's a certain number of plot beats that I could say that plot-wise, this is just what's going to happen, and I'm going to come into this. But the other reason I said in Harlem is, I mean, I was an English major in college, but also an Africana major. I read a ton of stuff about Harlem in the 20s. I read the Harlem Renaissance writers. I loved that period of time. So there was a way that I felt a certain confidence in using that time, but I did still go back and very quickly check. In particular, like the one thing, like where I can say, like what research is for is great for the Victory Club that I mentioned that is in the story. I had that was not in like the original draft of the book. I mean, the first pass of the story. But I knew I needed something, like I needed a place in Harlem because there's a mansion that the older white guy has, where mysterious things happened, and I knew I wanted to mirror that. I wanted something in Harlem that was also like a sacred space of some kind, but I couldn't think of it. I was at one point, it was like a diner where like ghosts eat or something like that. It was just stupid, you know, it didn't make any sense. And so I was just reading around and all this stuff, and I came across this article, this sociological article on this website called like Digital Harlem.
Oh yeah.
You know that one?
Yeah.
And it was about how were African American and Black Caribbeans treated differently by the New York City police in the 20s. Mm-hmm. And a passing thing in that was there was this story about this one immigrant from Guyana, I think, whose son got in a knife fight in the hallway of his building and was arrested. And it was about how the son was Guyanese, the person he was fighting with was African American, and how the police treated the Guyanese guy. The Guyanese guy got out that night. Mm-hmm. The African American dude was held longer, right? So that was what they were interested in. But they said in passing, one of the things that the father of that guy liked to do was hang out at this place called the Victory Club in Harlem, which was a social club for Caribbean immigrants. And I was like, now that's cool. Mm-hmm. And then I just started researching that, and I started finding out about that. And so all of a sudden, the world had given me this thing that I never would have come up with on my own, and then I stole. Right? And that in general, with writing, the world wants you to steal from it. Right, it's interesting for a reason, and that is so that you can write better stories. At least that's my feeling. And so it was a mix of the two, but I absolutely thought research was a degree of intuition, but bolstered by that research, you know, is my technique. So,
great.
Thank you.
Thank you both. If we could give Monica and Victor a round of applause. And again, on behalf of the Office of University Life, we're really pleased that you could join us this evening and help us launch this new series, Reading Columbia. I also want to put in a quick plug for our next event, which will be November 16th. It's the next installment of our series, Awakening Our Democracy, and the topic will be feminism, media, and the State of the Union. So please join us for that conversation.
Post-election, too, so that'd be
exactly.
Very nice.
That's exactly the point, right?
Yeah.
And then we have a reception, so please join us at the reception table.
All you students, eat that food.
Yes, please eat all the food. And thank you again for joining us, and thanks again to Victor and Monica for a lovely conversation.
Thank you.